What a beautiful day to be out in the Jeepster Commando.
Welcome back, I'm Tedward, and today, thanks to Bond Group, we are driving this beautifully restored 1968 Jeepster Commando. It's powered by a naturally aspirated 225 cubic inch V6 that makes about 160 horsepower and 235 pound-feet of torque. It's of course four-wheel drive because this little overlander is designed to compete with the likes of the Ford Bronco and the International Scout. I actually just ran into a big spot of rain and managed to get away fairly unscathed. This thing is absolutely fantastic, and if you are a Martha's Vineyard Nantucket type looking for the perfect beach cruiser, this will do the job. And honestly, these are still kind of bargains. I feel like Defenders get all of the attention, and they're great, but they're really expensive and difficult to maintain. I think this Jeepster Commando would give you plenty of presence, plenty of capability, and do it on a budget. This is a nice restoration. They took two 1968s to create this, and they've painted it in Mopar Destroyer Gray. I think that actually kind of modernizes the vibe quite a bit, having this color. So let me show you around first. Let's get under the hood. We'll disconnect these guys. They look like little elephants. And under here, luxurious struts. It's kind of clever how they did that. Probably pretty safe to assume these did not originally come with hood struts, but I do kind of love the design that they've made to make that work. And there it is. It's set way, way back. This is pretty much front mid-engine. Pretty trick stuff. And you can see the Holley valve covers and the Holley carburetor up here, but we do have an electronic ignition system, so it is running pretty darn clean. Inside, we have room for four. There's two little captain's chairs up front, and then back here, there is a bench with two seat belts. Probably terrifying to drive this on the highway, but I think as a little beach cruiser, this would do the job just fine. Up front, you can see they did a great job painting everything. Even the steering column is painted properly, and we've got this cool wood steering wheel. Now, this is not my favorite because this is a little bit harsh, and we'll talk about that when we're driving, but I would go with some maybe softer materials because you've got to put a little bit of effort into this steering. Down here, this is a check engine light of sorts. Not fully certain what that's for. I assume that is tied to the ignition system. I cannot imagine there is any type of computer system throwing codes in the Jeepster Commando. And then we have our nice canvas tent to keep us relatively dry, and it did the job today. In the rear, I love the simple blocky style of this. I'm digging these tail lights and all of the cool script and very on point vintage styling of all this stuff. This is as 60s as it gets. And to open the tailgate, we pop this off and this. And then this just folds right down, leaving us with plenty of room for stuff. Although, you do not want to put any sharp objects over here because this is actually your fuel filler neck, and that is quite exposed. So let's jump in, start up this dauntless V6 and see what it's all about. Now, I don't want you to get down on this transmission just yet, despite the fact that this is like one of the coolest automatic gearbox changing sticks I've ever seen in my life. I really dig this. But it's kind of nice to have this as an automatic. I'm not worried about, oh, there are crunchy synchros and this and that, and it drives really well. So our key is in the ignition. We've got 153 miles on the odometer here. Oh yeah. And I think this V6 sounds really mean. Oh yes. Now check this out. We've got monster frames on these windows. I love that appearance. That looks so cool. To put it in drive, foot on the brake. Push this button down, reverse, neutral, drive. Lurches forward, and away we go. The steering's pretty darn heavy. I don't think the mud drain tires really help that equation all that much. It does have power steering, but it honestly is probably heavier than my non-power assisted 911. boot full of brakes to get it to come to a stop. And the initial bite on the brakes is pretty good, but then if you just need to actually bring it to a complete stop, you've got to really get in it. I have found one electrical quirk, and that is when I engage the left blinker, sometimes it honks. I don't know why. It makes me sound a little rude, but let's see how she accelerates down the motorway. We'll not be trusting this because we are certainly not going 80 miles an hour right now. I can assure you of that. Four-speed does a little bit of gear hunting. It's definitely ambitious to keep you in the most top gear it can. The ride quality is actually reasonable. It's not as bouncy as I anticipated. And even though the steering's kind of heavy, it's giving me decent feedback. And I feel a little more confident in this than even some of the Broncos I've driven. So I've got to give props to whoever built this thing. Now I'm going to take a right-hand turn, no risk of the horn there. Playing any games, entering corners too hot in this thing. No, no, we'll take our time because, yeah, I'm sure it'll roll. I am sure you can push this into a roll. And as you can see, there's nothing on this vehicle that's gonna prevent my decapitation. Let me try to use my directional without beeping at anybody and being impolite. Nope. There we go. Is comfortable in the cabin, although the steering column comes up so high that the steering wheel blocks a lot of stuff. I can't really see everything. I've got to lean up. So if you're wondering if that's just because of the camera, it's not. That's, you're seeing what I'm seeing. All my controls over here, I've got to really lean for. Part of that is just because I'm sat a little bit further back than I normally would be from the pedals, but this seat is fixed. It is not on sliders. I don't know if that's a Jeepster thing or just a this car thing, but in this one, I am not going anywhere. From these mud terrain tires, but not obnoxious. Also, I can't imagine myself really taking this on any faster roads. I mean, sure, it could do it. The joy that I'm having in this truck is probably peaking at like 40 miles an hour, and every mile per hour faster, the joy would likely decrease. So I think I'm just gonna stick with it this way. There's our new wave overlander coming through. Personally, I would love to buy and build a cool overland truck, whether that's going to be like a Touareg or a Cayenne or a Tacoma or 4Runner. There's something about being able to capably go off-road, camp, explore, that really appeals to me. I love the bare bones vibe of something like this. I'm just not so sure that this is it in terms of actually usable stuff, because that means that if I was going to go way out into the wilderness and, you know, New Hampshire and Vermont, I know, wilderness, right? But somewhere deep into some forest land, it means that I would still have to drive this like 3 or 4 hours to get to those places. Is this the vehicle that I see myself driving often, hours and hours down the highway to get to those places? I'm not so sure. I think that's where like Toyotas and Cayennes come into play. Let's see. We'll go ahead and turn around here. I'm not going to use my directional because I don't want to beep at this guy, but we'll go ahead and turn around, head back the other way because I don't necessarily want to go down Route 2. This has a pretty terrible turning radius. You got to really muscle this thing around. Do a 3-point turn here. Into reverse. Tons of visibility. This is the stuff. I like that. I do love the idea of the roofless overlander. A lot of low-end grunt from this V6. This Dauntless V6 has so much torque down low. I mean, it sounds like it's just keeping the revs super low, partially because of that transmission, just wanting to upshift at any chance it has. But I don't feel a dearth of torque. Feel like I can always get through, and if we were off-road and doing a little crawling, I do trust this in 4Low to get me through some ugly terrain. This transmission shifts so smoothly too. It's not jarring. I was expecting this to be a real like bucking Bronco. No pun intended for its competition, but honestly, I thought this was going to be kind of a bear. And sure, it's bouncy and things, but mechanically, smooth, 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 like really lovely. So I think that's going to do it for me in the Jeepster Commando. The key takeaway for me in this is that this is like a sleeper of a cool vintage overlander on a budget. I mean, even as like a nicely restored vehicle, this is still in the realm of affordability. This is not a $100,000 vehicle. I don't even think it's a $50,000 vehicle. Nice and slow. Don't mess with me, Lexus, because my brakes aren't that fantastic. But if you're somebody who's kind of trying to get the Defender vibe, you want that style of vehicle, but you don't want to pay $50,000 for a rusted out piece of junk that you're going to have to go do a $100,000 restoration on, well, this just might be the ticket. So don't sleep on the Jeepster Commando. There's another Jeep in a similar destroyer gray color. I am superior in literally every way to that. Doesn't even care. No Jeep Wave for the Jeepster. You'd think I'd get a proper Jeep Wave in the Jeepster Commando, but apparently not. Apparently not good enough for that. So thank you so much for watching, liking, commenting, and subscribing. Don't forget to respect the drive, and I'll see you in the next one. And unlike the 48 Willys Jeep that I drove back in California that had a rusted frame, cracks all over it, it was a tetanus mobile, that was a proper death trap. I do think that this still, even though it's nice and well cared for and sorted, still a bit of a death trap. If we get an accident in this, it's not going to go well for me. I don't have any roll protection. I think that's something that if I were to be genuinely using this vehicle, I would install some sort of roll bar. And yeah, I've got a lap belt. I suppose that keeps me from being ejected from the vehicle. But here's the thing. If we have a head-on, this steering column is probably going straight through my face. So I guess it's better than going through my heart like in the Jags, but, you know, brains are important too. But man, if everyone was driving these, I don't think anyone would be texting, because I need two hands and a good bit of attention to keep this going straight down the road. It's not possible, it's doable, but being distracted in this would certainly put me into the other lane. So maybe car companies, rather than making it easier to text and communicate with the world, should make it more difficult and make it so your steering inputs are the difference between life and certain death. Beautiful day. Oh, beautiful day for the Jeepster.